Hello.
Hello.
I feel very at home here because obviously I'm a teacher and this is a classroom, so I will expect participation. Right, so I'm supposed to... I think among the things I'm supposed to be talking about is the precariat a class? Short answer, no. You can go home now. Essentially, we as Marxists distinguish ourselves from bourgeois sociologists, official ideologists, government statistics, when we talk about class, because we insist on the antagonistic relational nature of classes. That is to say, they reproduce themselves in and through struggle with one another. It's impossible to talk about, you know, in the traditional terms, the feudal peasantry, without some sort of relationship to the feudal aristocracy. An obvious example. No class can be said to exist on the basis... Can everybody hear me, by the way? Yeah? Okay, cool. No class can be said to exist on the basis of these epistemological premises without us having specified what is its relation to other classes and what is its mechanism of reproduction. And I'll come back to this later, the question of reproduction. But of course, the fundamental category of Marxist analysis is exploitation. For a class to exist, one class has to be involved in the production of a surplus, another class has to be involved in the appropriation of it, and any other classes you want to say exist have to relate to that process somehow. So that's the nature of the antagonism. And we aren't just talking, therefore, about strata, about lifestyle groups, about groups distinguished by particular cultural attributes. That is the approach of the official statistics, that is the approach of increasingly mainstream sociology. But it's not the approach of Marxists, and generally speaking hasn't been the approach of radical interpretations of class, whether Marxist or not. So class is fundamentally a relationship, or more complicatedly, a complex set of relations which structure and overdetermine the social formation that we live in. And that's why Marxist and radical analyses of class tend to be quite parsimonious, okay? Because we are looking for the fundamental explanatory principles that are involved in the organization of classes. Whereas if you look at, there's actually an analogy with a kind of the approach to mental illness here. I don't know if it's coincidental, but you know that if you look at the diagnostic and statistical manual and how it identifies various ailments and mental illnesses, it goes on the basis of various clusters of descriptive factors. So these are statistical constructs. And it's the same thing with the bourgeois approach to classes. They are statistical constructs. They're empirical entities. You decide that certain characteristics belong together, have a certain affinity, and you say that's a class. It's got nothing in common with our approach. And I would say that if you look at the result of that, in the UK since the end of World War II, I think there have been 17 social classes officially recognized. Although that's not, generally speaking, publicized. So the Marxist class analysis is explanatory, whereas I would argue that the official and bourgeois analysis of class merely demand further explanation. So why are we encouraged to believe that there is something called the precariat? In what context is this supposed to exist? There are various iterations of the concept in growing sociological orthodoxy, and it's usually treated as one of five or six or seven or however many classes that are supposed to exist today, distinguished by education, lifestyle, labor stability, and so on. Guy Standing obviously offers the classical articulation of this concept. What he argues is that a new multi-tiered class hierarchy is taking the place of the old, relatively simple class hierarchy of workers and bosses and middle class. And really what you have is the precariat forming one of those new types of class that are coming into existence. I want to point out this is a dream from heaven for sociologists. The idea of a new, more complex, rigorous, sophisticated kind of knowledge displacing a sort of traditional, fusty, overly simplistic, and no longer relevant kind of knowledge. Okay? But precisely for that reason, we should be skeptical. After all, as I've just pointed out, such complex tiered class systems really aren't very new in the history of sociological thought. And we have to look at what are the specific characteristics that supposedly make a precariat. Guy Standing offers his description. I'll read it out here. The precariat consists of people who have minimal trust relations with capital or the state, making it quite unlike the salariat. And it has none of the social contract relationships of the proletariat, whereby labor securities were provided in exchange for subordination and contingent loyalty, the unwritten deal underpinning welfare states. Without a bargain of trust or security in exchange for subordination, the precariat is distinctive in class terms. We could even take Standing at his word. I mean, I've no doubt that such people exist with such characteristics. I don't think we can have such doubts. But this doesn't make them into a class. There's one thing I said earlier that we look for in a class, one thing that every analyst of classes should hold as paramount above everything else, and it is the question of reproduction. I mean, this is not my opinion. Any child of five could tell you that if something can't reproduce itself, it's not going to exist for very long. So if you have a class, it has to be able to reproduce itself. There has to be a principle of reproduction. And therefore, if you're going to talk about class analysis, you have to talk about reproduction. If you can't talk about that, then you're not really talking about classes. And this isn't simply to, you know, attack Standing in the name of some sort of Marxist orthodoxy. I mean, actually, I think you'll find, if you haven't read it, you'll find it interesting. It's filled with useful data. It grasps, in my opinion, with a kind of political instinct that something fundamental has changed. And if he doesn't have a class analysis, I mean, my God, he's not the only one in mainstream sociology who doesn't have a class analysis. At least he thinks he does, and that's something, that's an advantage anyway. So my instinct is actually to reverse gear here a little bit and try to defend Standing against the orthodox, because the alternative offered by the likes of, I don't know if you've read Kevin Dugan, his book, which is highly critical of theories of new capitalism, but it's characteristic of the genre, using a statistical portrait of employment, of labor processes and so on, to convince us that nothing fundamental has changed, so that at the level of knowledge, nothing fundamental need change. The dead concepts of a dead tradition can continue to be passed from generation to generation, like embarrassing war memorabilia from your grandfather. And the young don't want it. They don't know what to do with it. They don't know who to pass it on to. It has no retail value. You can't flog it on eBay, so it just goes in the attic. And this is what happens to our concepts. So I'm not prepared to say farewell to the working class. I don't know about you, but I do think that André Gorz was onto something. I think that we should think about the ways in which he was onto something. We live in the era of the 0 hours contract. Is this term used in Croatia at all, or is it? It is. I mean, this is not new. I mean, I'm a writer, for fuck's sake. We are the original 0 hours employees. But then the reserve army of labor isn't new. The growing glut of de-skilled, low-status, dispensable labor isn't new. The increasing exclusion of young people from paid work isn't new. The growth of part-time and casual employment isn't new. These are generic tendencies in capitalism. But generic tendencies are just that. There's no reason why they have to be realized to any particular extent. And the fact of the matter is that not only have these tendencies been advancing steadily in the age of neoliberal capitalism, but In the era of extended austerity, they are deepening and accelerating in their spread. It's the name for this process. And here I will be quite orthodox. The name for this process is class struggle. Andre Gorz is actually a bit techno-determinist about this. What does he do? He looks at the consequences of automation. He looks at the fact that there's a declining, socially necessary amount of labor time that needs to be expended to make the stuff that we live on. He talks about the declining, socially necessary number of skilled, technically proficient, specialized workers who have a stake in the long-term success of their particular industry. And he says, well, you know, you can look at the consequences and see where that leads us. But what is socially necessary is by no means merely given. This is something that has to be fought over. If you are a worker in a factory and you're part of an organized group of workers and you fight for better conditions, higher wages, healthcare, redundancy protection, and you win these things, then they become, by definition, socially necessary. The process of production can't happen unless you are given these things. So what is socially necessary is always, to some degree, relative not only to technology, not only to certain conditions of production, forces of production, but also to the relations of production, to the ability of different classes to organize themselves relative to one another. And this is what Gorz, I think, doesn't sufficiently take account of. So when we say the precariat is something that exists and is growing, even if it's not a class, what we're really describing is a process of class struggle, and one in which workers are losing. And it is taking the working class on a process of transformation that is both molar and molecular. Now, we take these forms of precarity that I've talked about in terms of employment conditions, and you embed them in their rightful context. You can't really talk about precarity in your job without talking about precarity in your home. A neoliberal capitalism is unstable by definition because it is neoliberal capitalism, because it derives its growth, it derives its profits and its consumption through the giddily precarious, otherwise socially useless movements of financial capital. And this has even been libidinized. these volatile hot flows of cash on financial markets, if you think about it, are just about as sexy as an actuarial table. Just calculations of risk and reward, stuff that you do on a daily basis, elevated to the level of a technical discourse. And this has been offered as hot capitalist pornography. So we shouldn't overlook the satisfactions that we might get from this arrangement. I'm not just talking about libidinal investments and whatnot, but precarious capitalism does come with a degree of flexibility, a degree of choice. The opportunity not to work so much is actually an opportunity that many young people want to take on, even if it means living on next to nothing, even if it means having no resources, no savings, no possibility of getting on the so-called property ladder. And capitalist ideology is all about that margin, that tiny margin of choice that we have. And now look at what has happened since the credit crunch. You know that if you go to see a good psychoanalyst and say, I want to get better, the analyst, if he's good, if she's good, will say, or think, probably you don't. I mean, the reason you're here is essentially your real demand is to say, please fix my symptoms so I can go back to living exactly as I lived before, no matter how dysfunctional it was. And that's what we paid the banks to do. We gave them everything so that they could get the symptoms of financial capitalism working again for us, even with all its precarities. We gave them billions, trillions. We give them access, unprecedented access to political power. We talk about nationalizing the banks. We didn't nationalize the banks. We semi-privatized the treasury. This is what happened. And for what? so that we could go on making the precariat. And when we say we are all precarious, this isn't it isn't a badge of pride. We used to talk about working class pride, but this was really defiance against the kind of bourgeois contempt for working class people that we had. You're not really proud of being exploited. You're not really proud of being in a subordinate position. You're not really proud of growing up on a shitty council estate. And nobody's proud of being in a situation of precarity. A situation that really has been forced upon you by defeat after defeat after defeat. No one's proud of being defeated. When we used to affirm that we're working class, and some of us still do, it wasn't to express pride, it was to identify an axis of antagonism. It was to say that there's a problem, and it was to say that we mean to fight. And that is the situation with the precariat. The precariat is not a class. It is, in my analysis, an ideological interpolation, if you like. It calls upon, summons the expanding layers of people, starting with the young, the migrant, the marginal, women who are disproportionately in part-time and temporary and casual work, disproportionately dependent on the welfare state, disproportionately hurt by austerity. And it goes right up the chain, actually, if you think about it, precarity and its effects, to the mortgage-owning workers, to the proletarianized professionals, all of whom are now feeling some of what it means to be precarious. So when we say we are all precarious, what we're saying is that it is an exhortation to fight. And that's my defense of the concept. I'll leave it there. Thank you very much. So, I mean, are you guys going to ask me questions and, like, test me and stuff?
I just wondered what you would do with the concept of looping proletariat and precariat. Is there something that reminds you of that dream?
Standing really vigorously argues against the idea that his concept of the precariat is anything like the lumpen proletariat. And I think that... I think one can speak of a lumpen proletariat in a classical sort of Marxist sense. I mean, that the elements of that still exist. But I think the precariat is not the same thing, because if you think about it, the precariat is often young, university-educated people who are going into the job market, not really having much opportunity, essentially they are less nationally rooted. They're not likely to turn to crime or other means of subsistence. Lumpen proletariat is often more criminalized, more traditionally rooted, I don't think that the concept of the precariat makes sense in Standing's terms, but we can at least do him the courtesy of distinguishing it in the way that he would want.
Explain why precarious class is an ideological interpolation and working class isn't.
Yeah, I think that there are. I mentioned in the talk principles of reproduction, and I think this is very important. If you want to talk about the working class exists as a relation. As a particular relationship to the means of production, to the surplus, and to the owners of the means of production. Okay, you are in a relationship whereby you reproduce yourself through the sale of your labor power. That's how you do it. You've got nothing else. You know, we talk about private property and so on. If you really want to look at private property, look at liquid assets all over the world. And the people who really have property are the people who have liquid assets. In other words, stuff that they can dispose of. You know, property that they can they don't need to live on. Those are the I would say that's the ruling class, the people who have money to invest. So there's a relational element to this, and there's obviously an antagonistic element to this, because if you're selling your labor power to reproduce yourself, you're selling your labor power for on conditions whereby capital can extract a certain amount of surplus from you. They can make profit out of the whole circulation. So to me, that is, to an extent, a socially objective state of affairs, okay? Whereas the precariat, we can't identify similar principles. And for that reason, I can't see it as a class. I can't, you know, you could, I think you could, using Standing's approach, identify a certain social group which is fairly nebulous and is uncertain in its future and doesn't have any clear means of reproduction, and it could be a strata of a class, or it could be a social category that transcends classes. I just don't think it belongs in the realm of class analysis. But my preferred approach is to look at what this is trying to get at. It's trying to get at the increasingly insecure ways in which we live today. And that insecurity is built into neoliberal capitalism. And it's not sustainable on the basis of looking at changes in working patterns alone. You have to look at the whole social formation at every level to find those forms of precarity and the ways in which they affect us. And they affect growing numbers of people, not just a small class of young, relatively rootless individuals. That's the distinction I'm making.
You finished your presentation by saying that feeling precarious is an exaltation to fight. How do you envision the nature of this fight, against who, in what form, to achieve what, especially in relation to the failures of social movements in the years of the crisis?
That's a huge question, because, of course, I mean, the whole point about it is that it can take any number of forms. I think that one example would be that there are growing number layers of people. I say growing layers, I mean, this is the sort of consolatory language that we use, minuscule layers, which we hope will grow at some point, of workers who are trying to organize themselves, who have been disorganized in the past, and who are trying to organize themselves. And sometimes that takes the form of what you would call pop-up unions, wherein the traditional trade union bureaucracy isn't able to deliver, and so they form their own temporary ramshackle union, and it enables them to conduct a fight against management and to organize themselves on that basis. I think that that could form the original cell, the nucleus of something that spreads throughout the disorganized working class. Another way to do it would be to follow the lead of Bolivia, where, you know, neoliberalism was very, very advanced in its restructuring of the labor force, breaking up big, concentrated groups of workers into small, dispersed workplaces. And this is increasingly what happens everywhere. You know, workplaces are increasingly out of the way, increasingly small. And of course, you know, in a lot of these places, increasingly the workforce is casual, you know. I mean, I used to work in a call center. And when we looked at trying to unionize the place, one thing we found is it would be almost impossible to get a ballot of the workers there, because most of the workers on the books hadn't been seen for months and probably wouldn't ever be seen again, because they were off doing other things. You know, the only reason they were doing work in a call center was because they wanted to be an actor or a musician, or they were studying or whatever. So there was no permanent, stable workforce to ballot. Yet legally, all these people were on the books. It was incredibly difficult. So looking at that, they started to organize in communities and town centers. They said, you know, we want to have a union, and we want to reach you where you are, so you can join us as community members. That started to build up the basis of a kind of trade unionism. I think that could happen in Europe. I think that would be a good way to approach it. There's lots of different things. You mentioned something about the social movement format, but I'm going to leave that to one side for a moment. I'll come back to it, hopefully. Is there any women who want to say something? Because we've had three blokes.
Okay, that must help me. Well, I was wondering about the tendency of the feminist theory, which is based on a thesis that women workers actually affirmed the part-time and precarious works, as if that somehow part-time jobs was historically introduced by women workers, and it was said that it's like an emancipatory measure, so women can work part-time with it, stay at home. So how can we include that sort of analysis in a critique of a precarious class?
Yeah. That's really important. I mean, of course, it's absolutely true. Wherever you look at the growth of part-time work, you're looking at the expansion of female participation in the labor force. So the feminization of the labor force, it's very complicated. It's not straightforwardly regressive, obviously, because, and it's for one of the reasons why, when leftists moralize about commodification, well, I mean, commodification of female labor isn't necessarily straightforwardly a regressive thing. I think that my sense, and I don't speak for anybody, but my sense is that what women would benefit most from in this context is not necessarily to be without access to part-time work where that's available, but to have the choice provided by strong maternity cover, strong daycare cover, all the things that could be provided in the form of a social wage, enabling women, if they choose, to be a part of the labor force and to work full time. I also think that part of the problem is that employers are permitted obviously we have the situation where employers are permitted to pay women at a considerably lower rate, something like 30% lower than the going rate, if the work is equivalent in intensity and skill and so on. I mean, this seems to me to be a part of the stratification of the labor force, in the same way that race and other factors work to stratify the labor force, which reduces the overall cost of labor. And part of the problem that governments face when, if they even try to address it, which often they don't, is that if you introduce any serious measures combating that, all the poverty employers go under. Because actually most women who work part-time are not working for big companies that can provide, cover and all the rest of it. They're working for petty poverty employers who will go under. It's the same thing with migration. They depend upon migrant workers. They depend upon people who are racially oppressed. They depend upon women who, only have access to part-time work. It seems to me that part of the problem here is obviously going to be confronting the problem of capitalism itself. It's the same reason why you can't introduce a statutory sort of minimum living allowance without basically sinking all the employers that depend upon people coming to work for pittance. And it's the same reason why when we see things like workfare, I don't know, do you have similar things in Croatia, workfare? I mean, this is a global thing, right? So you have this situation where the burden of traditional citizen-based welfare payments is being shifted to a form of moral regulation. You have access to welfare if you prove that you're a good, moral, and virtuous citizen and that you're prepared to work and you have a work ethic. Well, okay, we know what this means. This means that women, particularly, we've already seen this in the United States, what happened is that women with children were forced to go into work without any support, actually, and go to work not for a wage, but for their miserly benefit. And we've got a system that is designed, obviously, not just to acculturate people to working for very poverty wages, but to sustain the glut of poverty employers. I don't know that there's a solution to that this side of capitalism, although my suspicion is that the government could, if it chose to, and if we fought for, sustain a much larger public sector and incorporate. And of course, the public sector is where quite a large number of female workers go to work anyway. So an expansion of the public sector, an expansion of provision, would be one way around that. It would be one alternative to poverty employment. I've tried sort of pushing a number of possible answers to that. I don't think I've brought any of them to the logical conclusion, but hopefully they go some way towards answering it.
The uneducated, the women, whoever, and then that will be this
We are eating artificial food, we are drinking artificial drinks, they are making us into robots. And very soon when new baby comes into this world, they will get a little mark which will guide them. And guess who will be guiding them? The robots invented in Japan or whatever. So I appreciate very much your thought on precariat, but I think we here have to deal with a much more important issue, and that is, in this time and age, everything, absolutely everything, has to be transparent. We've got to know how much these bastards on the top are actually earning. And frankly, you know, I try to read this and that, and I'm reading and reading and reading all kinds of, collecting all kinds of degrees. But as of late, I started to read liberation geology authors from Central and South America, because they are the only ones that made that make sense. And so, John Sobrino is saying in one of his books that if only 225 most rich men in the world, no, 125, give only 4% of their wealth, which they got to begin with illegally and in all kinds of, you know, breaking the law, whatever. There'd be no reason for any kind of law or war or whatever, because every single person would live a good life, would have a high quality healthcare, would have high quality education, and maybe the only problem we would be left with is what to do with all this free time, as they used to say 50 years ago, because 50 years ago they were thinking, oh, we are coming into an age of full human rights, we will have this and that, full employment, and the only problem would be free time. Guess what? Nobody has the free time because people have to hold four jobs just to pay the basics. And for what? For artificial food. While at the same time, sports and sex are heavily overrated, and trillions of dollars go to this side to just cloud more the whole situation. That in fact, everything is very simple. If we only have a wish and the will to make sure to know that indeed all human beings are created same and equal, should be created as equal. Thank you for your attention. My apologies. You know, I'm 7 years old baby, and I just fed up with all this.
There was a lot to respond to there, but I'm not going to. One thing that you said, though, that I do want to pick up on, if I may, which is this. I think you were right to draw attention to the separation of people as an aspect of precarity. I really think that if you look at neoliberal culture, we're often told that it's about individualism. It's not. It's about, I mean, even the individual can be fragmented and broken up. You could be broken up into cognitive capital, erotic capital, you know, physical capital. The point is that you are just so many streams of capital which can be put into circulation to generate an income. That's the neoliberal ontology, right? They don't really believe in the individual. They believe in the enterprise. So when you think about this, the situation of the enterprise is one that is inherently risky. In any economy, you are basically, you're taking a punt every single time you go out there to put some aspect of your capital on the market to return an income stream. It might go badly wrong. You might misinvest. You might miss an opportunity, you know. All sorts of things. And we are encouraged to embrace that risk as, you know, something that is actually, it's giddying, it's thrilling. I mean, that's precarity right there. And as I say, we should not be blind to the satisfactions of this, to the fact that there are reasons why people might go along with it despite all the dysfunctions. I mean, you know, you learn when a situation is far from ideal, you learn to somehow wrap up some form of satisfaction in that situation, to derive some sort of satisfaction from it. And that's what people have been learning to do. I think it's also important that neoliberalism has been restructuring our day-to-day lives. It's not just the big political battles where governments have been broken if they were on the left, where labor movements have been broken, these titanic battles. But on a molecular day-to-day level, it's very important not only that the public sector has been turned over to the private sector, that more and more things that we used to take as collective goods that we were entitled to by virtue of citizenship are things that we have access to through the medium of market relations and market exchange. Even those things which are available as collective public goods, if you think about it, I don't know if it's the same here, but if you're in the UK, you're a middle class family, you know exactly where to go and live, what catchment area, if you want your child to have the best education that will lead to a kind of middle class, to the perpetuation and reproduction of the middle class. If you're middle class, you will tend to know what postcodes are good for the NHS, what are the best NHS services, and you'll be able to fight for those things better. You have more resources. So even in collective provision, there's a competitive struggle. There's an entrepreneurial element even in the public sector, and that's been building up for some time. And that, of course, undermines and undercuts the public support for collective provision. One reason why we can't simply defend the status quo. There's a lot more of what you said that I could agree with and sort of try to expand on, but I won't.
Maybe a simple question, because I'm not into Marxism. There was a notion of the neoliberal and those who have money and system. So I was questioning, who is those, and is it really those who have the money, or are we also reproducing ourselves in our relations? I don't know. I just want, what if there are causal effects, or can we still blame somebody, the system, somebody to fight against, or is it more something who's up in relation to us reproducing ourselves? Maybe something like this.
I think I understand.
I don't have the notion.
No, but I think that there's a systemic analysis which looks at classes and their reproduction in a set of relations, and there's the fact that we are all involved in reproducing ourselves in relation to others, and then there's the question of political struggle and antagonism, and the antagonism that comes from the class relationship. So let's try and identify, I really want to do this, I want to try and identify the enemy, as it were, who we can, to some extent, blame for the situation. And I want to say that we can separate blame and responsibility, okay? We can blame the rich and the ruling class for the fact that this is their system. This is how, that class has, through generations, built the system. They have taken primary role in developing it and fighting for it and politically defeating its opponents. So we could certainly blame them. Responsibility is something else. We, as the working class, it doesn't really matter what sort of language we use here, but I want to refer to the working class as the working majority. We can take responsibility for the situation because, of course, the system wouldn't be reproduced without our contribution. And we have to think about the ways in which we are responsible for making sure it works and the ways in which we're invested in it. So, of course, we don't own capital, you know. I mean, if we do own capital, then we sort of become capitalists in that context. But most of us don't really own any serious amounts of capital. The only sense in which we have any access to capital is if we happen to have a pension. And many of us don't even have that. So, of course, we don't have control of markets. We don't have direct access to state apparatuses in the way that business lobbies, banks, and so on do. We don't control media corporations in the way that millionaires tend to do. We have only our control over our part of the deal, our part of the system, which is to supply our labor power at a wage. What does taking responsibility for that mean? Well, it seems to me that we have to think about what do we actually want in this situation and how could we use our leverage to get it? Because, of course, if the system can only work with our contribution, with our cooperation, well, there's a case for withdrawing our cooperation, you know. There's a case for disrupting things. I mean, I'm kind of tired, are you not, of this democratic spectacle? Let's go down and send a message, you know. We'll have a protest in the big square, and the media will report on it, and there'll be a message. And nobody will listen to it, because they don't care. But they do care if you disrupt things, and that's when they start insulting you, you know. And you're not doing anything right unless you're being insulted, unless the media are calling you criminals, unless they're, you know, accusing you of all manner of crimes, and unless the police want to have a word with you. I'm not saying we should fetishize this notion of being repressed and so on, but I think we should be looking to disrupt things and make life uncomfortable for them. And we can talk about strikes, we can talk about occupations, we can talk about sitting down in the middle of the street and not letting traffic go through. There's all ways in which you can activate your disruptive capacity. That's one way in which we could take responsibility for our situation. It means that we recognize that if we simply do nothing, if we have nothing but critiques, then we are, to some extent, perpetuating the system that that robs us. I'm sorry, I don't know if I answered your question at all.
Yeah, kind of.
Okay, kind of. All right. Well, you can email me if you.
Yeah, I don't know, just like, oh, if it's these notions of neoliberal, the system. I don't know. Sometimes for me, maybe it's very much ghosts.
Yes.
The notions.
Yes.
As such. So sometimes too many.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Well, I mean, absolutely. I mean, there's a sort of ideological specter of the rich man or whatever. Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah. And we shouldn't get too much invested in that. The question is, it's a set of relations, right? And that's what we need to focus on. And as relations, that means that we are involved. Sorry, you had your hand up there, I think. I understand this completely because, of course, obviously I work in a higher education institution in addition to doing my PhD there, and I'm aware of the graded differences between teaching staff and cleaning staff, for example. And I think that when we're talking about ideological interpolations, when we're talking about precariat, we are all the precariat, what we're trying to do is precisely what you just said, establish a chain of equivalence that links some aspect of my experience to your experience, to their experience, and so on, so that we can unite. But we need a unity in difference, a unity in complexity, and a unity in contradiction. In other words, we need to take into account the fact that the chains of equivalence are just that. They don't mean that we are all identical in our situation and in our context. What consequences do these differences have politically? Well, there's one way we can approach it, which is this sort of increasingly Americanized way, which is to call out privilege. You know, you know, check your privilege. Or the alternative is to say, you have privilege? Great, use it, help us. And the thing about it is that the more privileged academic workers do have some clout. They do have some ability to disrupt things a bit more. They do have more of leverage in the academic institutions. So when cleaners go on strike, if the teachers go on strike with them, it will be a lot stronger. That's putting it simply. So it's a question of political class leadership. And political class leadership is not won by saying, you know, my interests come before yours, or, you know, by, you know, ignoring the differences that you refer to, but rather by fully taking into account the fact that there are these differences of privilege, and using your situation, you know, whatever it happens to be, to mobilize for the most militant struggle. I regret to say that in the UK, at least, it's not the teachers who are the most militant. It's, I mean, the teachers, if anything, are remarkably conservative. I don't mean this in a sort of big C sense. I mean tactically, strategically, mostly they're aligned to Labour. But in terms of, you know, when the cleaners go out on strike, like the Three Coasts campaign in Birkbeck, I don't know if you, any of you have heard about this, but there's cleaners, mostly migrant workers, and they're very militant. There's not really a lot of support from the teaching staff, to be honest. There's been a campaign, and it's developed some support. But really, you know, it would be ideal, and it would be a manifestation of a political success if the teachers could be won to a position of using their privilege to help those workers, because it would actually help them in the long run. That's the thing. They have an interest in having a strong labor force that isn't partially outsourced, that isn't divided by these hierarchies wherein they can reduce the overall wage burden. Does that answer? Okay, all right, yeah?
Sorry, I'm asking a second question. I'd like to get back to your notion of labor leverage and the fact that you succeeded in Bolivia. I think the situation is quite different in Europe. I would like to ask you what prevents the investing class, as you call it, of Europe, from bypassing the organization of labor through delocalization, knowing that within the neoliberal discourse and its expanding legal framework might just be the excuse that they need to further delocalize. In relation to that, what do you think about movements that do not just sit on the street or organize labor, but like the Zapatistas and the Kurdish people in Rojava, who have not actually demanded anything, but simply taken what they thought was theirs, through whatever necessary means they thought were necessary. So, in Europe, we are faced with this investing class that is in that
class. Okay, all right, so that's two slightly different sort of subjects, and I will come to them respectively. The first thing is the reason why Europe doesn't, European bosses, capitalists, don't simply bypass the unions. It's because they still need a mediating structure. It doesn't matter what neoliberal ideology says. Yes, there's a certain kind of neoliberal praxis that is built into statecraft, and it works to an extent. But they're pragmatic about it. They, you know, they need a mediating structure to deal with the workers. If they don't have a mediating structure, what's going to happen is that the, you know, you're going to have an unmediated conflict with the workers, and that can get hairy and unpredictable and scare off investors and, you know, hurt profitability.
The workers have voted for the Conservative a few days ago.
Which where?
In the UK.
No, mostly it wasn't workers. I mean, yeah, some workers did. Actually, I'm more worried about the workers that voted for UKIP. But you know, the real problem is that most workers, I would say you'll find almost 50% of the working class didn't vote. They just didn't vote because the traditional representative link between Labour and Labour Party, organised Labour, and the wider extended working class is breaking down. And that's irreversible, and we simply can't save that situation, therefore need to move on. But whether or not the Labour Party exists, there will be a trade union bureaucracy, and that will mediate, to some extent, the relationship between capital and the working class. That's what it exists for. So I don't think they're just going to bypass it. I think they're going to need it. But I think they could use a more tame union structure. I think ideally they would like something like the company unions, the business unions of Japan or the United States, you know? So we shouldn't overlook that possibility. The second question you raise is, what about these autonomous zones that are created, the Zapatistas, Rojava, you know, the Kurdish struggles? If you can take strategically important territory with viable resources and build a viable community, fine. I think mostly you can't. I think most of our experiments in this direction have meant taking strategically unimportant territories and not really taking them, just briefly occupying them until the police come along and disperse us. I fear that there is an illusion that came out of the Zapatista movement and that fueled the autonomous current in European politics, which said, you know, somehow we can opt out of the state. We can't opt out of the state. The state is not the same institution it was in the 19th century. I mean, maybe it never really was this ideal sort of night watchman that just watches over things and keeps, you know, and protects the boundaries of property and so on. But if it ever was, it certainly isn't today. It expanded massively. It integrated internally, articulated more and more areas of life. Its legitimacy is built upon its reproduction of aspects of day-to-day life, its deployment of material incentives, left, right, and center, as it were. And really, I mean, if you think about it, the state is always there. A bit like God. I mean, you know, if you think about the idea that when you're born, there's the birth certificate, there's the hospital, so the NHS in the UK, I don't know what your system is here. So there's already a bureaucratic imprint. You've been assigned a nationality, you've been assigned a name, you've been assigned a gender, you know. The state is already very much involved in deciding your life pattern. There's the, you know, maybe child benefits, schools, street sweepers, council housing, lighting, you know, from the unemployment office to all the way to the grave. The state is always there organizing aspects of your life, culturally, politically, in terms of your identity, in terms of who you are. The state is very much involved in your life. The idea that you can opt out is ridiculous. Yeah, I think you can fight within the state. I think you have to look at the state as a field of strategic struggle and antagonism, which, I mean, in terms of the apparatuses of power, they are monopolized by the ruling class, but you can build up resistances. I mean, one of the things about neoliberalism has been the desperate struggle to drive the working class out of the strategic areas of control that it had. You know, in the UK, this meant smashing militants, smashing left-wing labor councils, smashing the Greater London Council, and so on and so forth. That's what that meant. It also meant introducing things like what were called compulsory competitive tendering, which meant that local services had to be tendered out to local businesses rather than the preferred union workforce. So in other words, that restructuring of the labor force to drive out the working class, and also, of course, the restructuring of, state apparatuses in a different way, taking democratically accountable state apparatuses and functions and turning them over to NGOs or quangos or business lobbies, not just privatizing them, but semi-privatizing them, the PFIs and so on. Increasingly, the space in which ordinary working people can have some sort of control over the state is being squeezed out. But nonetheless, it is a space of antagonism. I mean, there is a big public sector. There's a huge public sector workforce. And neoliberalism requires the increasing hierarchization of that workforce and the proletarianization of previously middle-class professional groups of workers. And these are processes that are going on. I'm not saying they're concluded by any means. I'm not going to claim that teachers are, you know, salt of the earth working class, certainly not in the UK. But, you know, these are processes that are taking place. And so we have to have a struggle within and against the state, if you like. That's my approach. But then that's, you know, I'm a left Polanskian, if you like, so that's right. I agree with some of what you just said, in as much as I do think that this idea that we can fall back on traditional social democratic nostrums, the right to work, security, and so on, that's not necessarily going to be the way forward. I would qualify what you say, though. I mean, I don't think it's true that there is a significant group of people for whom the state provides nothing, because...
But that depends on geography. That's back to the point that she said of geography. There are parts of the world where there are huge, large amounts of people where the state, that are not part of the... where the state provides nothing.
Can we talk about some concrete examples then?
Oh, I'm thinking about what would be called the precariat in a country like Colombia, one of the countries with most, you know, with the highest difference in income and class differences. So you have half of the population or a third of the population where you have really nothing. I mean,
Anyway. I thank you for making that point. I think that's very important. Actually, I mean, this is one of the points that I made about standing, which is that he focuses on the precariat as if it's a distinctly European phenomenon, whereas actually it's concentrated in the continent of Africa and to some extent in India and Latin America.
I myself work with Roma, gypsy people, and that's also something which you have right here, where the state, the only presence of the state is the repressive force, nothing else.
Yes. And the same thing with migrants. If they come and try to get into the European Union, you have illegal pushbacks, you have camps where they're...
Like, why are we asking this question? Because like there's a lot of attention now to Roma inclusion or inclusion of gypsies in the society, but the tool which is being planned is the labor market inclusion, and I think this is like something that is going to bring a big progress.
I hear that. I think, obviously, there's a contest between a kind of if you like, a kind of bourgeois progressivism, bourgeois cosmopolitanism, let people come and work, you know, and fill up labor shortages and so on, and hopefully drive down wage costs and things like that. That's partly the calculation. And on the other hand, the sort of racist, nationalist, xenophobic response. And we want to find a way beyond that. I think, in the short run, my inclination in that struggle is to start by fighting for their rights within the terms of bourgeois progressivism. In other words, to say that they have a right to work, they have a right to be respected as human beings, have human rights, and so on. But I would also want then to take it to the logical next step, which is, yes, if they have the right to work, then they have the right to be represented. They're paying taxes, they have a right to be represented politically. If they are producing wages, then they have a right to be organized in a union. And I think that then what we would want, I mean, ideally, I think what you would need is a political movement of the migrants, because, you know, it would be nice if some wider political movement would allow them to sort of take up a leading role within them. But I think it's more likely and more plausible that they will have to organize for their own interests. So, perhaps one model might be, if you look at what happens in California with undocumented migrants there. And I'm not saying it's going to be the same in Europe, it's just not, because the culture is totally different. It's much harder for undocumented migrants to do anything here. But if you look at the effect that a very well mobilized militant immigrant community can have politically, I mean, I think for one thing, it actually does have the effect of radicalizing the politics. It does have the effect of strengthening labor's side of things. I think, therefore, that if the working class here was to recognize that it had an interest in a well-organized migrant community, that really they should be getting involved in defending their rights and giving them the maximum space that they need to get organized in their own interests. I'm not sure, though, if any of those answers that I've just floated are by themselves sufficient. I mean, it sounds like you may have some experience in this direction, so maybe you have some alternative answers.
Well, I just think my question was basically, what do you do when you cannot get all these goods which you just named, because they all are mediated through the labor market participation, and just the labor market just doesn't have a capacity to integrate more, actually it's losing capacity even to keep those which are there. So how do you organize when you don't have the access to this working class identity? Because what you name about taxes and being a good citizen, it's all mediated through this being a worker, but there's growing number of people who are not having this door open anymore. Yeah. And there's a big number of people who've never been there.
I think one thing that I would say about that, I don't have a comprehensive answer to that challenge, but I think it requires a lot more work. But one thing I would say, just to qualify what you just said, which is this, we should not regard labor capacity as a given quantity, right? Labor market capacity fluctuates depending on the labor that is available. And one thing that changes, we noticed this in the UK actually, when a large number of first Polish workers were permitted to enter the UK labor market. Of course, the racist right said that unemployment would be driven up, British workers would lose their jobs, yada, yada, yada. What really happened was that total employment increased. And the reason it increased is because the cost of reproducing the labor of a Polish worker is considerably below the cost of reproducing the labor of a British worker. And that meant that new jobs could be opened up. Now, that's a capitalist principle. It's unfortunate, but we live under capitalism. But the point about it is that if you were to, I suspect, if you were to say, just you know, let migrants come and work where they can, you would probably see an increase in the level of employment. And the result of that would be a Keynesian multiplier effect, in as much as with more people employed, more people driving money into the economy, you would actually expand the opportunities available for indigenous, so-called indigenous workers. I know there's more. I suspect there's a lot more work needs to be done, but I'm merely pointing out that we shouldn't take labour market capacity as a fixed quantity. Other questions, contributions, anything? Yeah.
You mentioned earlier the salariate, and it's a concept that has been propagated by Žižek for once, and Guy Standing himself, and Standing opposes the salariate to the precariat in his analysis, thus creating a drift between them and fostering a negative solidarity and all of these problems. So. What can you say about that? We had the salary that still has some kind of syndical representation, still enjoys some benefits, some workers' rights, is in some way holding the standard of workers' rights in for the whole economy. So. It does seem like the case of a divided rule, but what can we say about the salariate? Is it a class that is that better off, and what are the implications of ruining trade unions if they are not what they used to be, but they are still better than, I mean, there is more strength there than in anything else, like Occupy movement that is not so... durable.
Yeah, I mean, look, I'm afraid that the way in which the concept of the salariate is being used by Žižek and Standing is pretty reactionary. For this reason, in the UK, one of the major lines of attack of the Conservative government and the previous Conservative Liberal coalition was to say, look at these privileged workers with their gold-plated pensions and their security and their wages. You know, private sector workers are expected to tighten their belts, but you've got here this group of workers, privileged workers, mostly in the public sector, and they're not paying their fair share. They're not tightening their belts for the recession in the way that the rest of us are. And, you know, it's, to me, that is obviously about dividing and rule. It's a salami strategy. But more fundamentally, this concept of the salariat, what is it? I mean, how are we supposed to identify it as a class? What are its principles? What are its means of reproduction? How does it relate to other classes? You know, I mean, one of the points of class analysis is that a class cannot exist unless it relates to other classes. It cannot exist except in a relationship to other classes. So therefore, you know, you cannot talk about a class in existence before it's been in contact with others. Well, what we have here with salariate, the newly affluent, you know, all these different sort of multi-tiered classes, is that they are statistical constructs which, in principle, they don't need any other class to exist. They don't have any principled relationship to other classes, and they don't have any principle of reproduction. I think in Žižek's terms, it's this idea that, and please correct me if I'm wrong, if you guys know better, but I think it's something to do with the idea that the salariate accumulates rent mainly through the public sector system, but takes a degree of rent. Manages to do so through its successful labor bargaining position. I think we have to look at rent-seeking activities as a serious aspect of neoliberal capitalism. But if we're going to talk about rent-seeking activities, we can talk about landlords for a start. We can talk about the bankers. We can talk about financiers. The only sense, I think, in which a group of workers who are being identified as the salariat are implicated in rent-seeking, and I think many people in here will probably recognize this. How many of you have pensions, for example, that are floated on stock markets or that are dependent on future values of financial markets? I guess some of you must. Nobody wants to put their hand up. But the point is, the fact is growing layers of the working class do. And growing layers of the working class, if they have any savings, their value will depend upon the future value of stock markets and so on. So their wages, which have stagnated for a long time, are being supplemented to a degree by rent, by the redistribution of surplus value. And I would say that we should look at why that is, and why that is necessary to the overall reproduction of the system. It seems that the share of national wealth that goes to workers in the last 30 or 40 years has dropped. In the UK, it dropped by something like 10%, its total share. Which, you know, in strict Marxist terms means that there's been an absolute increase in the rate of exploitation. So basically, more surplus is being pumped out of workers and distributed as surplus value. Well, I mean, in that case, I don't see that there's a huge problem with one group of workers getting some of that back through the financial system by whatever means they can. I don't think that that is a political problem. But more importantly, I don't think that that in itself, and to some extent, you know, if you own a house, you're going to be implicated in this. If you really want to have any kind of viable future stable life, say if you want to raise a family, you're going to be involved in this somehow. So I don't think we can identify it as a specific class. I don't think we can identify it as a political problem or even a political opportunity. It just is a tendency within neoliberal capitalism. And it's something that ever-growing numbers of us are going to be involved in somehow. It does have a problem of meaning that we are dependent on the banks. You know, we talk about the fact that you know, the banks, we say, are parasites. You know, well, yeah, they are parasites, and yet somehow we're dependent on them. So, and that will continue to be the case until we have developed a satisfactory alternative to the existing organization of capitalism. Was there any?
I have a few questions that come from the source of my one big question. It's about knowledge. And teachers and students, somehow, I hear all of this. I always come to the one point that teachers are passing our knowledge to students, and then we have some kind of problem, which comes from the point of view that teacher needs to integrate that knowledge. Student. So I will be precise from my experience. In this country, I'm a single mom and I'm working and studying, and I kind of mainly get through all of this. So my question is, if we need to have direct transparency from communication, and if I need to get, I need to trust my teacher that they will guide me through all this, so I can manage all of this question, where to put, which thing to be, for example, artist that will bring the knowledge on. So what is the solution? I mean, how can I, get,
Well, you should never trust your teacher. And I'm not even joking about this. I mean, look, politically, we have to have an approach to education that is based upon the agency and the will to learn of students. And they, I mean, it is not a case, as I, you know, I've been teaching now for 3 years as a GTA, and my experience of this is even more so than I would have expected, that it is not a case of me sort of having knowledge and pouring it into their heads and then they have the knowledge and so on. That's the discourse of the university, you know, that we have this dead knowledge that we pass on and then they pass on this dead knowledge to other people. That is, and obviously, if you create a system that is based upon guilt, you know, you only do things because you're made to feel guilty if you don't. And you're going to, someone's going to punish you if you don't have your essay in on time, and if you don't attend all the lectures and so on. Well, if you have a system that's based on guilt, of course, you know, you prohibit real learning, and you do make it about the transmission of dead knowledge in that sense. But at some point, it has to be about the facilitating and encouraging students to develop their own knowledge, to decide what they want to know, to realize that they have a central agency in this, and also to realize that quite often the teacher doesn't really know more than they do. And this is true. I mean, my students are second year university students. Most of the time, they are far greater experts in their subject, and they don't know this. And I don't tell them. But they are far greater experts in their subject than I am. And the more that they get towards the end of the year, the more they start to realize this.
Then I have two questions. Like, for example, do we have time for that? If we talk about, for example, food and all kinds of problems that we are up to now. So we have now a problem, and we need to get at some point to realize that problem. And then we have to have solution get solved that problem. So,
sorry, what was the problem that you cited as an example?
I mean, like we said about teaching and everything, mm-hmm. So we have a real urgent problem all around the world.
Yes.
I have like food, for example, because food, it's the main problem, food. Food is a really big, big issue.
Yeah.
And we are still like have to take responsibility for our lives. I mean, not in the circumstances like take your things, but inside ourselves, we need to realize that we are not taking responsibility for our lives. We need to get that in the conscious. We don't see that. And then we can talk about solutions.
Yes.
So it's kind of, do we have a time?
Do we have time? No. I mean, look, if you think about it, the environmental disaster is already upon us. We don't have time, but we don't have an alternative. I mean, unfortunately, none of us can press a button and make everybody think overnight. And we are, many of us, still stuck in this situation where we transfer knowledge onto experts, state technocrats, businessmen. They must know what they're doing. What could I possibly know? I'm just some small guy on the street, you know. I'm doing my job and trying to raise a family or whatever. And as long as people are in that subservient relationship, that's a problem. Political awakening, the term is used for a reason. Political awakening primarily involves people deciding that actually they probably know a bit more about how to run the planet than do the people who presently run it. And that's not, you know, we cannot expedite that process by any means. We can just continue to work away. And, you know, at certain points of crisis, people will start to think. Unfortunately, the ruling class are not stupid. They do sort of know what they're doing. You know, even if they don't have the solutions for humanity as such. So it's very rare to catch them on the hop. But once in a while, we will. And when we do, provided we intervene intelligently, we can break that sort of transference relationship. Guys, I don't want to keep you here longer than you want to be here. But if there are any, I'm happy to stay if there are further questions. If not, we can go and have a cup of tea and or whatever it is you drink in Croatia.
Coffee.
Coffee?
Yeah.
People are sick.
We have a whole
coffee. Oh, thank you.